Good afternoon, everyone. And the first item of business this afternoon is consideration of business motion 14261 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a timetable for the Stage 3 consideration of the British Sign Language Scotland Bill. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press the request to speak button now. And I now call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move the motion 14261. Minister.
Moved.
Thank you very much. As no member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I will now put the question to the Chamber. And the question is that motion number 14261 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. Thank you very much. We now move to the next item of business. Thank you. Point of order from Liam MacArthur.
Thank you very much, Deputy President. Obviously, the motion in the name of the Minister asks Parliament to welcome a specific point within the updated 2020 route map for renewable energy in Scotland, namely, quote, that it records a significant increase in the generation of electricity from renewable sources. The nature of this debate was agreed by Parliament last Wednesday. The parliamentary clerks asked for indications of debate speakers last Thursday. The Minister tabled his motion on Tuesday. It referred to that specific point within the report. But the Scottish Government did not make the report public until this morning. While it was circulated to members last night, this only happened at 10 to 6, well after the deadline for submitting amendments. At the very least, this shows a lack of courtesy to members by the Minister, which is regrettable, but also somewhat surprising, not least given, I think, the broad welcome the report has received. Could you, Deputy Presiding Officer, in order to allow business here to take place in a courteous manner, ask the Scottish Government to make sure that in future it gets organised and publishes any document in time for amendments it is going to quote selected parts of the report in its motion to be amended? Thank you very much.
I think Fergus Ewing wants to respond to the point of order.
Just to respond to that point, I do accept, Ms MacArthur, that I would have preferred that the document be published earlier. As soon as it was brought to my attention that it was not published, steps were taken to rectify that. As Mr MacArthur said, the document was communicated to all MSPs last night, but later than it should have been, for which I apologise, Presiding Officer. I do hope, however, that the information contained in the document is information that is relatively straightforward and familiar territory, for, I think, for all of the members in this debate.
Many thanks. And since I have to rule on that matter, Mr MacArthur will know that this was not a point of order and that the timing is a matter for the Government. However, I do welcome the Minister's apology in this occasion, and I hope that it won't happen again. Many thanks, Minister. And we now move to the next item of business, which is a business debate on motion number 14272 in the name of Fergus Ewing on the future of renewables in Scotland's energy policy. I'd invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Minister Fergus Ewing to speak to and move the motion. Minister, you have 10 minutes, please.
Plenary Officer, earlier this week I set out the Scottish Government's views on what is needed to sustain the oil and gas sector. Its continued health is important in its own terms, and particularly as we transition to a low-carbon economy. We have already achieved much as part of this transition. Today I wish to update members on our success in delivering a marked increase in renewable electricity generation as described in the updated 2020 route map for renewable energy. Provisional figures show that we generated a record 49.8% of Scotland's gross electricity consumption in 2014 from renewables, well on course to meet our interim target of 50% by 2015. We are committed to increasing community and locally owned generation towards a target of 500 megawatts by 2020. I have just heard this morning, Presiding Officer, that we have now passed our target with nearly 12,000 individual installations across Scotland. 61 megawatts is wholly owned by community groups, and there are now 45 examples of shared ownership, nearly quadrupling last year's figure of 12. We continue to support the work being done in carbon capture and storage, and it is extremely exciting then that the world's first full-scale gas carbon capture and storage project is moving closer to being built in Peterhead. We are also supporting Summit Power's Caledonia Clean Energy Project, providing £2.5 million from Scottish Government to support the development of the CCS Clean Energy Project in Grangemouth. We continue to champion wave and tidal energy technologies, both through the creation of Wave Energy Scotland and through our investment in MayGen, the world's largest planned tidal stream energy project. The onshore construction phase of the Pentland Firth tidal project is well underway, and I was delighted to hear this week that the project owner, Atlantis Resources, is relocating its corporate head office from Singapore to Edinburgh. We are also making progress in other areas. On energy demand, we've achieved an 11.8% reduction against a 2005 to 2007 baseline, almost achieving our 12% target figure well in advance of the target date of 2020. We have set a clear framework to support delivery of low-carbon affordable heat through publishing our heat policy statement in June this year to focus and drive the pace of change and set out a framework for investment in a low-carbon heat sector. We have supplemented our support through the establishment of the £76 million low-carbon infrastructure transition programme, which is a Scotland-wide cross-sector project development unit to support the development and acceleration of low-carbon infrastructure projects in the next 3 years. Under that programme, I launched the Geothermal Challenge Fund earlier this year. Today, I am pleased to announce that we are turning our attention to accelerating large-scale water source heat pump projects to support low-carbon district heating schemes in Scotland. £375,000 is being made available to help with the development of business proposals, whilst a further £2 million will be available to support a commercially viable demonstrator project. Despite our success, Presiding Officer, we now face significant challenges. First, security of electricity supply now under threat across the UK. Across the GB, spare capacity in the system could be as low as 1.2% for this winter. Second, UK charges prevent new thermal plants being created in Scotland, as we called for in 2013. In Scotland, Scottish Power has confirmed that Longannet will close on 31st of March next year as a result of discriminatory transmission charges. They also confirmed that it would not be progressing with the development of a CCGT gas plant at Cockenzie, and I quote, due to the same economic conditions affecting all thermal plant in Scotland. Third, the UK government have carried out what can only be described as an assault on renewables. This includes the early closure of the renewables obligation for onshore wind and solar PV projects, and the review of the feed-in tariff scheme, and the proposed removal of FITS accreditation, and, bizarrely, removal from renewables of the exemption of the climate change levy. These have caused widespread uncertainty and concern. And indeed, a report by Chartered Accountants Ernst & Young, published earlier this week, shows that investment in onshore wind energy is already being hit. Chartered Accountants, not necessarily known for the use of extravagant or colourful language, said, "The UK government has sentenced the renewables industry to death by 1,000 cuts." EY. Fourth, we wait to see if the UK government and the Prime Minister himself honour their promise to connect the North and Western Isles, Northern and Western Isles to the UK grid, or whether they will remain separated therefrom. These decisions, taken since May, cut to the heart of a major Scottish interest, and yet they were done without meaningful consultation, despite the recommendation made by the Smith Commission to do just that. This raises questions about the extent to which energy issues are and will ever be given appropriate consideration by the UK government. Without the appropriate recognition of our role in setting the policy framework, Scotland risks missing the opportunity to cement the growth of our renewable electricity industry with significant supply chain benefits whilst decarbonising our energy supply. Our ambition set out in the Electricity Generation Policy Statement, EGPS, to largely decarbonise the electricity grid by 2030, to greatly enhance community renewables and have a balanced generation mix, are unchanged. But within this context of future UK policy uncertainty and a lack of clarity on whether it will serve Scotland's interests, I want today to inform you of my intention to begin a process to ensure that we have the best suite of policies to address the future challenges of delivering affordable, secure, low-carbon energy supplies, not just electricity, but heat as well, given that heat is by far the largest source of our energy demand in Scotland at over 50%. I'll take Ken McIntosh.
Thank you, Minister, for giving way. The Labour Party can clearly make common cause with the government on the UK government's decision to close the ROC scheme a year earlier than originally planned. Although clearly we wish to press them to rethink or negotiate at least a transition period, can I ask the Minister if he has considered, or will he consider, using the Scottish Government's power to extend the ROCs over this transition period? Until the ROCs are actually closed, in other words, for the next year, the Scottish Government has the power to issue its own ROCs, paid for not by the UK consumer, but paid for here in Scotland. Has the Government considered using its power to do just that?
Thank you. Minister?
Well, first of all, we have, as I think Ken McIntosh acknowledges, pressed the UK Government very hard on this matter. We know that the UK Government have a mandate in their manifesto that there should be no new subsidies. However, I would argue that the decision taken to curtail an existing subsidy scheme does not accord with the wording of that manifesto, because it is not a new provision. It is the curtailment of an existing one. Secondly, I have not only pressed this matter in writing and letters, but I've also had a meeting with Amber Rudd in the summer to press our concerns. That made no impact whatsoever on the UK government. As to the specific question Mr. McIntosh raises, we do not have the budget in order to pay for reserve matters which are the responsibility of the UK government. Our overall vision, Presiding Officer, will be to reduce overall energy demand in the system in the first place by focusing on heat demand reduction, further addressing household fuel poverty and helping reduce costs to improve the competitiveness of our business and energy-intensive industries and the efficiency of the public sector. We need more local heat generation supply and energy storage at transmission, distribution and household levels. We have many of the building blocks in place. In June, we designated energy efficiency as a national priority. I will say more about that when I close, as I cut through some of the remaining speech, which I've run out of time to deliver because of taking the intervention. But can I say that, of course, we will be, in all of this work, as always, drawing on advice from experts across the sector, including members of the Scottish Energy Advisory Board, for the purposes for which I've clearly set out earlier. This will underpin our work over the coming months towards an overarching energy strategy for Scotland, setting out what we can do to optimise the benefits of Scotland's significant energy resources and expertise through to 2030.
Many thanks, Minister, for cutting your speech short. Very much regret we're incredibly tight for time today. Now call on Minister on Sarah Boyack. 7 minutes if you speak to and move your amendment, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Well, predictably, we were asked to welcome the SNP's new strategy, which, of course, we hadn't seen, but charmingly, Fergus Ewing acknowledged the fact that it probably wasn't that important that we had seen it before today's debate, and implying it wasn't that radical. Now, I do think there is a lot we can agree on in this Parliament in terms of renewables. I personally have pride at setting the first target, which then was seen as bold and brave. And if I can say, it wasn't what the officials thought we would do anyway. There's a danger about targets that are what you're going to do. There's also an issue about stretching targets. And I think we need more stretching targets now. The power of setting a stretching target and adding political leadership, working with business and the higher education sector on innovation, on design, and a degree of consensus across the chamber, not all of the members all of the time, did let Scotland really do something different when this Parliament was set up. There's much to be proud of, and it has continued over the first 15 to 16 years. And I do want to say that we are absolutely appalled at the way that the UK government is putting real developments, scuppering projects, where companies have put in tens upon tens of millions of pounds in good faith. That is unacceptable. It's all right for the UK government and the Scottish government to disagree with each other now and again. That's the nature of government. But to put at risk those developments when investment in renewables and infrastructure needs long-term certainty is unacceptable. And on that issue, we are as one with the SNP government. The Ernst & Young report quoted by Fergus Ewing is a massive blow to investor confidence, an immediate impact on jobs and the supply chain. And the Scottish renewable figures that they've given us today highlight the fact that we're talking about 1.25 million homes that could have been served and £3 billion of investment. And then you've got the community impact. This is a hugely retrograde step. I also want to highlight the threat caused by the review of the feed-in tariff scheme, potentially a massive impact on community projects, have always been slower to get going and actually are just now coming into their own. And for the future reference, I hope the Minister will have a look at the issue of whether tying in energy storage and heat batteries might make it still possible for some projects to go ahead, particularly in relation to solar PV and domestic and commercial rooftops. I think we've now got to think quite creatively, and we've really got to sit down and say, how are we going to move forward for the long run? We've got the CFD uncertainty, currently no commitment beyond March 2016. That is a critical issue for banks and big investors. So I believe that we need high-level engagement with the UK government and in public with UK ministers. We need to get to a point where we might have differences between different governments across the UK in tone, in emphasis, in style, in substance, but we have a UK energy market. We have UK consumers. So that difference has to be respected. And the precipitate withdrawal of both feed-in tariff support and the support for ROCs is not acceptable. And UK ministers must now work and exercise political humility and a bit of leadership with other administrations in the country. It's bad for jobs and investment. And it's appalling in advance of the climate talks we will have this December. So our motion focuses on the need for a long-term strategy with stable finance and a better planning regime. And across the globe, countries are looking at low-carbon economies, preparing for the transition that we need for cleaner energy and cleaner industry. And we need to be part of that, not behind it. And in preparing my amendment, which I move in my name, I did think about trying to put something that would be acceptable to the Minister. And I reckon that actually I wanted to go further than the Minister would go today. I wanted to go further than his officials would advise them, because we need to be more ambitious. And what's happening at the UK level makes me even more convinced of that. I do ask the Minister goes away and looks properly at the point that Ken McIntosh made. In 2005, we supplemented the marine renewables, the ROCs, with a higher level of support. It is a UK issue, and I ask the Minister to look at all options. Just look at the money that is there and think about how it needs to be spent in the next year to 18 months because of the loss of investment and jobs. Our amendment highlights other work that urgently needs to be achieved. A much better integration, a real integration between renewables and the energy efficiency strategy, both on domestic and non-domestic sectors. We need to make political priority for energy efficiency, particularly in the business sector. There are massive savings to be made, and meeting with companies last night, I was absolutely struck by how all the really big opportunities they're investing in are not in Scotland. We need to fix that. Now, that means looking at domestic fuel, we're not going to meet the abolition of our fuel poverty targets, of the fuel poverty in Scotland next year, no matter how many times ministers re-announce the budget. We need a more radical approach. So more on community and cooperative schemes. We need a more joined-up approach with our local authorities. You look at the impact of local authorities in terms of staffing and expertise and the impact of the underfunded council tax. They are understandably cautious. And yet, South of the border, local authorities are doing much more radical stuff and much more practical stuff now. So we need political leadership, we need political determination. Minister, you will have our support to do that, but you also need to raise your game, I think, particularly in terms of the local targets. They are nowhere near radical enough to drive the change we need now. It is difficult. It will need us to work together. I'm incredibly disappointed with the Conservative amendment today. It could have been more constructive, I believe. It could have acknowledged the impact that the UK government's changes are going to have on Scottish industry. One simple thing the Scottish government could do, accelerate the permitted development rights issue. I've called for it for a decade. Great, we're going to get air source heat pumps. What about non-domestic solar too? We've just got to raise our game, and everybody needs to be part of that process. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. And I now call on Murdo Fraser to speak to and move Amendment 14272.1. Mr Fraser, up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Scottish Conservatives have always believed that renewable energy has a part to play as a component in Scotland's energy mix. We certainly don't share the single-minded focus of some other parties on onshore wind as a technology, but we do want to see a balanced portfolio of renewable energy making a contribution. And there are a great many success stories in Scotland that we can all celebrate, whether that's hydro, wind, biomass, air and ground heat pumps, solar, wave or tidal. Now, we know, and we've heard it again today, that the Scottish Government is critical of the UK Government's plans to cut subsidies for wind power. I would just remind members that these were signalled well in advance of the general election. It was back in April 2014 that the then Energy Minister, Michael Fallon, made it absolutely crystal clear that any wind projects which did not have planning consent and grid connection by the date of the general election would not be eligible for subsidies thereafter, and he was simply reiterating what had been stated previously. All this party has done is hold true to its manifesto commitments and keep its promises. And why have we done so? No, I need to make some progress. Why have we done so? Simply because the costs have been spiralling too high. The respected Scottish economist, a specialist in energy, Tony Mackay, calculated that wind farm subsidies in Scotland were between 2.5 and 3 times higher than those actually required for these to be built. Tony Mackay puts his best estimate at 2.8 times. In his words, this means that developers have been making supernormal profits from these projects, all at the expense of the electricity bill payer. Yeah, I'll happily give way. Yeah.
Thanks, Ewan.
But does Mr Fraser not realise that it's surely perverse that the UK decided, for the objective of reducing costs, not to reduce the cost of the most expensive form of delivering renewables, but to reduce the cost of the most efficient and the least expensive, namely £80 per hour per megawatt hour for onshore, as opposed to in excess of £110 per hour for offshore wind? Does he at least acknowledge that there is an irrationality to the argument that he has just mentioned?
Well, I thank the Minister for his intervention. I thought, you know, the Minister represents the Highlands. I thought he'd be concerned about fuel poverty. Electricity bill payers are paying more, according to The Economist, who I think lives in his own constituency, 2.8 times more than they should be for onshore wind. I think he'd welcome a reduction in the subsidy being paid for by his constituents for this technology.
Yeah.
And we need to remember that if we add together all the projects already constructed, all those under construction, and all those which have planning consent, we will have exceeded our target of 100% of our electricity needs for renewable energy by 2020. We cannot go on pouring public subsidy into one technology when our targets are already being met. And of course, these proposals have had a warm... No, I need to make some progress. I've only got 5 minutes. These proposals have had a warm welcome from communities across Scotland and from conservation groups such as the John Muir Trust. Tony Mackay himself commented, "The UK government's proposed changes may not be ideal, but at least they are a sensible way forward. They will not result in a reduction in wind energy capacity in Scotland, but may slow down future growth. Hopefully, they will result in lower electricity prices for consumers in Scotland." Now, we heard an awful lot of doom and gloom in the Chamber about what these subsidy changes will mean for the renewable energy sector. Fortunately, not everyone involved takes such a pessimistic view. Brian Galloway, Energy Policy Director at Scottish Power, wrote in July, "My view is that once the dust settles, we will come to understand that onshore wind still has a vital role to play. I remain optimistic on the prospects for Scotland's onshore wind energy." The Canadian company Brookfield Renewable Energy Partners said in August they were planning to build up to 200 megawatts of wind farms in Scotland before the end of the decade. their president commenting that these projects really can stand on their own 2 feet without the need for significant subsidy. And we see a similar picture in relation to solar power. Of course, it was back in 2011, when there were previous subsidy changes, that SNP members in this chamber were predicting the demise of the industry. Mike McKenzie, MSP, said of the change then, this could have a devastating impact for households and businesses and housing associations across Scotland. Of course, it had nothing of the sort. The solar PV industry went from strength to strength.
Members, in his last minute, I'm sorry.
The president of the British Photovoltaic Association, Greg Barker, has called on the sector to avoid the hysteria and self-damaging doom-mongering that we saw in 2011. He added, around the world, the solar industry is already operating without subsidy, and there are still further opportunities to create additional value and extract further efficiency savings in the UK sector. It is time to muster up an optimistic can-do ethic and talk up the huge success and enormous potential of UK solar, not plead for years more subsidy, as the Minister is doing this very afternoon. Presiding Officer, renewable energy still has a bright future, despite all the doom-mongering we hear from the other benches today. The UK Government is taking the right decisions to protect consumers and should be commended for doing so. I have pleasure in moving the amendment in my name.
Many thanks. Very sorry, we're very tight for time. Now move to open debate. Up to 4 minute speeches, please. Graham Day to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the limited time I have, I want to focus on the impact, the all too real impact, that UK Government actions are having here in Scotland on our efforts as a nation to green our energy generation, on some of our communities, and on an agricultural sector seeking to diversify. Let me offer a few examples by way of illustration. 15 kilometres off the coast of my constituency lies the planned Inchcape wind farm, which has the potential to power up to 500,000 homes. But it was unsuccessful in its bids for contracts for difference earlier this year. The developers will try again in the next round, but of course with absolutely no guarantee of success at the second time of asking. Unsettling times, made even more unsettling by the fact Inchcape, along with three other proposed offshore developments, including Alpha and Bravo Sea Green, planned for a little further off the Angus coast, await the outcome of an RSPB instigated judicial review expected within the next couple of weeks. Now, of course, you cannot blame Westminster for the actions of the RSPB, but you can blame the UK Government for its approach to offshore wind and, for that matter, solar and onshore wind also. It seems eye-watering subsidies for Hinkley Point. With all the concerns which exist over whether or when it might begin generating are fine, it seems pushing fracking is fine. Supporting renewables in all their guises and in any meaningful way is very best on the wane. So much for David Cameron's pledge that he would lead the greenest government ever. But it isn't just in an upfront way that Westminster is undermining our drive to become a renewables powerhouse. Presiding Officer, I have a farmer on the coastal strip of my constituency who has spent in excess of £60,000 thus far to secure conditional planning permission for a single 800 kilowatt wind turbine. The consent is conditional on MOD radar interference mitigation measures, a solution for which was accepted by Defence Estates back in 2013. The farmer has secured a grid connection at a cost of a further £120,000. He must pay a £10,000 deposit on that by October the 9th. However, the MOD, despite the fact RAF Lookers is now closed as an airbase, is demanding that further radar mitigation fieldwork be carried out at a cost of £1.2 million, the cost to be shared amongst a group of farmers, another three of whom I understand to be constituents of mine. The total number of turbines involved in Angus runs into double figures. The farmer who came to me has been told his phase one share of what is termed continuing development of the measures, and there would be three phases all told, is going to be £12,000, which must be paid now if his turbine is to be retained within the project. He would face a similar charge at phase two. No estimate for a figure at the final phase is available, nor is there a timescale for when deployment of the system can be anticipated. Proposals by DEC to reduce tariffs drastically for this scale of turbine come January, and the decision to remove the ability to tie into current rates by pre-registering a project means this proposal, unless commissioned within 12 months, which isn't possible, is no longer viable. The farmer has been advised that rather than commit another £22,000 to the project just to keep it alive, he should quit now, right off the money he has spent thus far. And there are many others, individuals and groups, facing similar choices now. Whilst in Rural Affairs Committee business earlier this week, I heard of a community turbine proposal in the Callander area supported by a £145,000 Community Renewable Scotland grant, which aimed to provide an income stream for a variety of local projects over the next 20 years, and which is now at significant risk because of the changes to the feed-in tariff regime. Presiding Officer, as these examples demonstrate, there are painful economic consequences to the UK Government's retreat from supporting renewable generation for individuals and communities. The consequences in environmental terms will be even more serious. In advance of Paris, the UK Government needs to rethink its approach. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now call on Liam MacArthur to be followed by Claudia Beamish. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much indeed. As colleagues will know, I'm delighted always to have an opportunity to debate the issue of renewable energy and ways in which we can harness the enormous potential here in Scotland, given our world lead in natural resources, research capability and skills base. As the update report published today makes clear, we are seeing good progress, albeit, as Sarah Boyack indicated, we could and should be doing more and better in a number of areas. However, while I agreed with pretty much everything that the Minister had to say in his speech, I was a bit disappointed by some of the wording in the motion. Arguing that, quote, Scotland's energy ambitions cannot be delivered is, I think, a council of despair and, in fact, untrue. Sarah Boyack's amendment makes this and, I think, other highly relevant points very well. The Minister has an excellent track record, I think, in trying to build consensus and focusing on those areas of agreement. I wish he would continue to do that and avoid lapsing into finding excuses to rerun the referendum, or rewrite the Smith Commission, or indeed reignite political differences that the sector is desperate for us to avoid. That said, I do welcome confirmation of the significant increase in generation of electricity from renewable resources. It's encouraging with regards to our interim target and for laying the foundation for reaching the 100% target in due course. This is something that Scottish Liberal Democrats strongly support, having been responsible in the previous executive for setting some of the early stage targets on this journey towards decarbonising our energy system. And I think, as I said earlier, the political continuity and consensus we have seen is important. For the sector, it has helped remove some of the political risk. Under the previous UK coalition government, while there were differences, and I think Sarah Boyack alluded to some of those, I know Fergus Ewing enjoyed a good working relationship with successive Lib Dem energy secretaries, particularly my good friend and strongest possible advocate of the renewable sector, Ed Davey. Sadly, since May's election, we have seen a different approach. Like the Minister, I am dismayed by what seems to be a cavalier attitude adopted by the current Conservative government. Their plans to close the renewables obligation were, as Murdo Fraser indicated, signposted, but the decision to accelerate those plans by a year was irresponsible and, I believe, in bad faith. Not only has it undermined a great many projects, including around £100 million worth of... I've not really got time, I'm afraid... including around £100 million worth of community projects, along with the other measures referred to by the Minister, it has not confidence in the wider renewable sector beyond onshore wind, and even the Tories may come to regret that. Looking at the overall picture, I obviously have a specific interest in marine renewables, where Orkney has led the way, but since the last 2020 update, things have not been easy. The challenges facing the wave sector in particular are significant, although I still firmly believe that it and tidal energy have a key role to play in our renewables future. As well as the technical challenges, it is the continued lack of grid infrastructure that poses the greatest risk. I know that this is not an easy nut to crack. Were it the case, it would have been sorted already. However, without a clear and urgent timetable for delivering this key strategic asset, the threat to the development of renewables in the islands I represent should not be underestimated. This is not just a concern for Orkney in terms of the potential loss of jobs and wealth creation. It matters for Scotland and the UK, who will struggle to meet the renewables and climate change targets without Orkney playing its full part. Meantime, as I said in Tuesday's debate, innovative solutions are being identified to better use the resources we have available. The Surf and Turf project is looking at how hydrogen can be used to run our ferries. Installed renewables can and should be used to heat and power the replacement Balfour Hospital in Kirkwall. And there are opportunities to use renewables and special tariffs to deliver affordable warmth, helping, along with energy efficiency measures, to reduce the scandalous levels of fuel poverty that blight my constituency and many like it.
Must close, please.
The Minister can count on my support in helping deliver these and other changes that demonstrate what our renewables future should be about. And with that, I pleasure in closing.
Thanks very much. Now call on Claudia Beamish to be followed by Mike McKenzie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the lead-up to the Paris summit, climate justice here in Scotland is of vital importance. As an example of inclusive action on the global stage, communities and workers must be at the heart of a just transition. I've recently spoken about how it is essential for the Scottish Government to have a strategy for the development of transferable skills for the future in relation to the challenges faced by the oil industry in the North Sea. In the lead-up to the Paris summit and beyond, we must also ensure that rural Scotland is not left behind in a just transition to a low-carbon economy, supporting our communities and signalling that rural communities across the globe must not be marginalised. There are some fine examples of transition at a community level. Some of these have been supported by the Scottish Government Climate Challenge Fund, such as the Lanark Development Trust and Peebles Cairn. Going around my region, I have seen cause for optimism. I've spotted a van of a company called EcoEdge tucked into a driveway of a small village. They install biomass boilers. I've witnessed the installation of a wood pellet boiler by a resident in the village of Douglas. But how many residents in rural, isolated areas and off-grid dwellings can afford to do this? In some parts of South Scotland, you can't even find a plumber, let alone someone to fit a biomass boiler, air source heat pump, or a solar panel. What is the Scottish Government doing specifically to support the start-up of small rural businesses to take up the opportunities offered by the transition? And what has been done specifically to support transferable skills for small rural businesses? And how are these opportunities being promoted? Can the Minister reassure us today that the Rural Fuel Poverty Task Force will offer truly inclusive solutions? And what is the timescale for this recommendation? We must also focus in the lead up to Paris, as well as supporting through the Climate Justice Fund abroad, women in Malawi and Bangladesh. We must also look at women here in Scotland today and the contribution that they are making to renewable energy action. And it is a significant opportunity to stabilise the gender imbalance in the energy sector. Without the barrier of an entrenched inequality in a long-standing industry, women are making a valuable contribution to ensuring our emerging renewables is globally competitive. And I was pleased to see that the Scottish Government commit to ensuring policy development is adapted to helping women to reach their full potential, which has already reached an increase of 28%. Continued research and monitoring is key to ensuring fair funding and skills development opportunities, and particularly for women in rural areas. In the lead up to the Paris summit, we must be able also to show clearly that renewable energy must be connected and combined with energy efficiency for there to be success. Some councils have been brave despite the challenges highlighted by my colleague Sarah Boyack for councils. This includes my own council of South Lanarkshire through their investment programme in their housing stock, which has moved on to improving energy efficiency in properties they own. In Clydesdale, they have started a programme of works for rural off-grid areas such as Douglas and Forth, where they're replacing old heating systems with air source heat pumps. In addition to this, using government funding, they've been putting external cladding onto older wooden houses in places such as Lanark and Carstairs on a universal basis in order to act as insulation where there is not a cavity wall. If we lead by example, by being inclusive in our actions to develop renewable energy and energy efficiency in Scotland, we can truly be an inspiration to the rest of the world in the lead up to the Paris summit.
Many, many thanks. I now call on Mike McKenzie to be followed by Patrick Harvey.
Presiding officer, ever since Margaret Thatcher began the privatisation of our energy system in the early 1980s, UK government energy policy has been progressively failing. Back then, we had a robust system with inbuilt resilience and spare capacity. The term fuel poverty had not yet been coined. Now, Ofgem have been repeatedly warning about the lights going out. Spare capacity is down to 2%. National Grid is buying in spare capacity generation at absurdly high prices. And when energy is in short supply, the price goes up. It is as simple as that. The UK Government Energy Plan is building more interconnectors to Europe, hoping to buy in energy from elsewhere at who knows what price. And the other part of the plan is to spend £35 billion on the new nuclear reactor at Hinkley Point. I hope Mr Fraser is listening carefully. A subsidy of over twice the wholesale price of energy for 35 years. A further £10 billion is to be spent on necessary infrastructure. Huge amounts of money delivered straight into the hands of Chinese investors and a French state-owned company who are already asking for more. No EPR reactor has yet been successfully built. The Finnish and the French EPRs will cost at least twice as much as they were supposed to. The two Finnish EPR reactors are already 5 years behind schedule. Who knows what the decommissioning costs will be? Sellafields are approaching £70 billion and the job is by no means finished. They plan to buy in energy anywhere they can, except, it seems, Scotland's renewable energy. And yet, we were told during the referendum that if we voted yes, the broad shoulders of the UK government wouldn't support Scotland's renewable energy sector. The trust of many people in Scotland is now severely strained because the UK government, Mr Fraser's government, is now in the process of rapidly withdrawing support from our renewable sector. And this is no means just about onshore wind. Wave energy companies like Seatricity have relocated from Orkney to Kirtwall because they lack a grid connection. I'm sure Mr MacArthur would be pleased to confirm that. The European Marine Energy Centre on Orkney, 10 years ahead of the rest of the world in wave and tidal research, has recently made 25% of its workforce redundant. And the Green Deal is being withdrawn because it's not fit for purpose, although I've said this from the start with its unworkable golden rule. And it's not just about what's being done, it's about how it's being done. Some subsidies have been withdrawn with undue haste. Investor confidence is severely shaken. Trust is easily lost, but it's very difficult to win it back. And in the investor's world, this means very much higher returns on investments, perceived as risky, not because of the technical challenges, but because of an inconsistent and incoherent energy policy on the part of the UK government. Jobs are being lost, investment is being lost, and climate change targets have been threatened. It's time, Presiding Officer, that this Parliament and this Scottish Government had full powers over energy so that we can reverse these misguided decisions. If not, we all face a future of energy prices that are much, much higher than they need to be.
Thanks so much. Now call on Patrick Harvey, after which we'll move to closing speeches.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the 2 minutes. I apologise for the oversight in not submitting an advance request to speak for the debate. It's not every day that I find myself coming to the Chamber and on the same side of a debate as Fergus Ewing. What a rare pleasure. I'm sure there'll be many other opportunities for us to disagree on fossil fuel policy, to disagree on aviation taxes, but on this occasion, we have some common ground. And I should imagine that my reaction was much the same as Fergus Ewing's reaction when we heard Murdo Fraser tell us that we should be talking up renewables at the same time as his own party colleagues are pulling the rug from under the industry. I think that is a position which is completely untenable. And that is, let's make no mistake, that is what the UK government's recent decisions have been about. A slew of them, just at the beginning of our own summer recess, leaving us without the opportunity even to challenge these issues on the record at the beginning of summer, whether in relation to the subsidies for solar and wind, as we've heard, or indeed the policies on reducing our demand, which is the other part of the sustainable energy future that we need. In the time available, I want to make a case for just one additional policy change from the Scottish Government, though. They should be commended for having reached ahead of time, or almost reached, the target for community and locally owned renewables. But community and locally owned renewables are not the same thing. They're both good, A small business, a farmer or another small business investing in some renewables and community ownership, these are both good, but the challenges on these two different forms of renewable ownership are different. And I would put in a case for the Scottish Government to accept that they've reached this target, set a more stretching one, but set two of them, one for community ownership, including local authorities, and another for local private ownership. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on Alex Johnson to wind up on behalf of the Conservatives. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. This has been an interesting but, I suspect, a very predictable debate. We've heard from the Minister something we've become used to in recent weeks, and that is wheeled out once again the begging bowl mentality, complaining that the UK Government has somehow, by the withdrawal of subsidy, not only undermined what he claims repeatedly to be a highly efficient form of energy production, but also that this has been done without any warning. Well, as was pointed out by my colleague just earlier in the debate, Michael Fallon, the then Energy Minister, made it very clear as long as April 2014 that it was the intention of this government to withdraw these subsidies for onshore wind. The only surprise the element in this was the fact that none of his political opponents expected him to be the energy minister after the general election. And that surprise, I think, has cut to the quick with many of those in this debate. The truth is that Scotland has a huge number of wind turbines in place, and that this high-cost form of energy has had the result of pushing up energy prices across Scotland. At a time when we should have sought ways of increasing the diversity in our energy market, we have chosen an expensive option and we have, in many respects, pushed fuel poverty upwards. Of course, when I say it's an expensive option, occasionally we hear the Minister and the First Minister also at times telling us that this, of course, is one of the cheapest and most efficient ways to generate electricity. Why then do we have to subsidise it? If it is the case, then we must remember that it is important to target resources at new and diverse ways of encouraging additional environmentally based renewable energy sources, and that means ensuring that the ones that are most efficient and should be paying their way are not in receipt of subsidy payments which should be going to other sectors. This Scottish Government has become obsessed with onshore wind. It has interfered in the planning process to ensure that many of these onshore wind turbines have been built in areas where local authorities would have sought or have sought to prevent them. Planning has become a lottery because of that interference, and over large areas of Scotland, people are genuinely upset by the way in which this has been conducted. I took the opportunity to go to the top of the Garvick Hill near Lawrencekirk last weekend and was able to count over 100 industrial-scale wind turbines from a single standing point. That is an indication of what this government has done to Scotland and a responsibility for which they must be held to account. We have huge opportunities for a diverse and well-developed energy policy in Scotland. We have huge opportunities to bring in additional resource from offshore wind, from solar photovoltaics, from wave and from tidal power. But if these opportunities are to be taken, we must not make the mistake of pursuing a single method of production of power to the exclusion of all others. This single act by the UK Government, predicted and flagged more than a year in advance, has been a courageous move to ensure that we see finally movement in the energy market, particularly for by the reduction in support for offshore wind. I support the amendment in the name of my colleague Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. Now call on Lewis MacDonald. Dr MacDonald, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. There is, of course, broad agreement in theory on the objectives of energy policy, security of supply, affordable energy and tackling climate change. But today we have heard very different approaches as to do, how to do all of those things at the same time and about the priorities we should set. Onshore wind, of course, is today's headline issue, and successive Scottish governments have followed the lead given by Sarah Boyack as Environment Minister in the first session of this Parliament in setting ever more demanding targets for renewable energy. And the private sector, the industry and communities, by their investments, have helped those targets to be met. The British Labour government of 1997 to 2010 also played an important role. It created a single GB energy market covering Scotland, England and Wales, and it devolved the system of renewable obligations to provide public support to private developers. The single market, renewable obligation certificates and ambitious Scottish targets have together stimulated a dynamic and successful wind energy sector. So successful indeed that the need for public subsidy was coming to an end, and the industry was clearly gearing up for moving to the next phase of its development in the next couple of years. What a pity the Conservative government lacked the wisdom and judgment to allow that maturing to take its course, and instead chose to rip up the subsidy regime and deny support to some very good projects which were not quite ready to go, when an extra 12 months of support could have made all the difference. Of course, the details of how these subsidy schemes will come to an end are still up for discussion, and the Scottish Government can and I think should play a strong role in negotiating with the Department for Energy and Climate Change on cut-off dates and grace periods to determine which projects in the pipeline will or will not qualify for subsidy. This is clearly of great urgency and importance to project developers, large and small, as Mr Ewing's reference to the EY report itself indicated. We have been asking on clarity for some time, and I hope the Minister will make clear what he expects to be able to achieve with the powers and influence that he has. It is, of course, the case, as Ken McIntosh pointed out, that the Scottish Government has powers to address this not through additional public expenditure, as the Minister's response to Mr McIntosh implied, but by directing existing renewable obligations certificates to sustaining good projects currently at risk. We would simply ask the Scottish Government to look at that again. Good projects have also been put at risk in deployment of solar power, which is, if anything, closer than onshore wind to reaching the stage of profitability without subsidies. It is frankly bizarre that a party in government which would claim to be a friend of business and of farmers should sabotage investment plans and block the rollout of small-scale wind and solar projects in the Scottish countryside because the government at Westminster could not find a smarter way to shift the energy balance in the direction they want. It is not too late to do something about that, as we have heard this afternoon. Briefly, please.
Mackenzie.
I think we're all in agreement that subsidies should gradually be rolled back as technologies come to maturity. We're in disagreement, I think, with the Tories in terms of the speed at which those are being withdrawn. But how do you justify the huge subsidies that the nuclear industry is receiving, given that if it's not a mature technology by now, when will it ever be?
Lord MacDonald.
Isn't it a pity that Mr Mackenzie doesn't take the hint about building consensus and agreement across parties which oppose the actions being taken by the Tory government at Westminster? I'm afraid with that approach we may have to work harder to achieve that consensus going forward. At least I would look to David Cameron to agree to his ministers sitting down with the devolved administrations across Britain to find ways to restore investor confidence and to enable small-scale developments to go ahead. In the summer, I visited the first community-owned wind turbine in mainland Scotland at near Rudney in Aberdeenshire, and I saw the benefits of solar roof panels at the National Trust's Pitmedden Garden. It is difficult to see the basis for anyone wanting to stymie projects like these, and I hope ways can be found to make more of them happen. The Scottish Government can, of course, now act on one area where it has power to do so by promoting the deployment of solar panels on government buildings and public sector housing across Scotland. Some councils have already done this very effectively, including Aberdeen City Council, and it would be a pity if Scotland's devolved government continued to lag behind. Aberdeen, of course, is also best in class for combined heat and power, not just in Scotland, but across the UK. The last 3 years have seen major extensions to the CHP networks put in place in social housing and public buildings in the city, over the previous decade. It is a model for district housing which the Scottish Government should also support, especially where it is possible to do so from renewable sources. And I was pleased to hear of small but welcome steps from Mr Ewing today. The Aberdeen CHP example also points to a wider challenge, how to reduce carbon emissions without adding to consumer costs. The installation of CHP in tower blocks in Aberdeen has seen reductions of 45% in both greenhouse gas emissions and consumer bills. It is exactly that kind of community-based development we should be supporting, the Scottish Government should be leading. And there are opportunities too to make the response to the pressures on the oil and gas industry to have share the skills and technologies in offshore fabrication as well. An imaginative response is above all what we require today. An imaginative and inclusive response from all who share the objective of taking forward a renewable sector, and I hope that that is what we can build across most of this chamber.
Many thanks. I now call on Fergus Ewing to wind up the debate. Minister, you have up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have enjoyed moments of this debate, and let me try and respond to some of the specific points put, although I fear not all will be possible. I agreed with a great deal of what Sarah Boyack said, and to respond to her point about doing more in relation to local energy systems, we are already, in fact, encouraging local energy systems, encouraging a mix of technologies with storage, to which she specifically alluded in the groundbreaking CARES Local Energy Challenge Fund demonstrator projects being funded this year with an LEF fund of £20 million. Each of these is a groundbreaking, innovative project, and certainly some of them fall into the categories that she, I think, would support. She also mentioned permitted development rights, and we already have permitted development rights for some air source heat pumps. She mentioned extending that to solar. I think I may already have said that if she wishes to write to me in that matter, then I will give it very serious consideration. I think we are coming from the same direction on these matters, and it behoves us to work together where there is common ground, and I pledge that we will most certainly do that. And Patrick Harvey, well, I'm very sorry. I'd like to try and cover as many points as I can in this debate before moving on to make some final comments. Mr. Harvey was kind enough to acknowledge the achievement today, just today in fact, of the community energy target, I think we're very proud that we have in Scotland achieved what appeared at the time when we set it, 500 megawatts of community schemes, to be an ambitious target. And I acknowledge that much work was done with the support of colleagues in the Labour Party, the Liberal Party and the Green Party. Of course, in response to Mr Harvey's specific request, we will look now that we've achieved that target, it is sensible that we look now to establish what is appropriate to achieve in the future, and obviously we have high ambitions, as does he, so we will give careful consideration to the matters that he has raised. I acknowledge Mr MacArthur's long-standing commitment to renewables and agreed with a great deal of what he said, although I thought it was a little bit ironic that he berated me for making critical remarks of the UK Government, which he then said later in his speech was acting in a cavalier fashion. But let me not be churlish, so I won't really mention that any further than that. Suffice to say, and I think this is the most important point, that we do try to develop as much common ground as possible in Scotland on these matters. The challenge we face is that the Scottish consensus on energy policy does not appear to match the London agenda. That is the predicament that we face. And let me set out what I think do form components of that Scottish consensus, Presiding Officer. Firstly, that we need much more emphasis on energy efficiency and demand reduction. And of course, this applies to our own estate. So we've announced our intention to do much more in our own estate, the public building. Secondly, we need much more energy storage solutions, both at transmission and at household level as well. So, for example, the Corrie Glass scheme, which I consented to SSE, the Cruachan scheme, these would offer tremendous additional pump storage capacity. The benefits of pump storage do not appear to be recognised by National Grid. I invited them to look at this at an ILG meeting, which I co-chair. I do believe that where one looks towards increasingly a low-carbon electricity generation system with forms of energy which are intermittent, including hydro and wind, although they themselves are a very good fit, that storage solutions are necessary in order to provide the equivalent of backup and baseload in the past. I've always argued, although Mr. Fraser does not seem to recognise it very frequently in his remarks, that we need a variety of sources of generating electricity. And indeed, I previously quoted Winston Churchill, who said that when it comes to the problem of electricity generation for a country, the solution is variety and variety alone. I see that the mention of Winston Churchill has roused Mr. Fraser.
Very briefly, please, Mr. Fraser.
I'm always grateful to the Minister for mentioning Winston Churchill, for giving way. You'll be aware from the discussions we had last evening that yesterday the output from wind power across the whole country was precisely zero, and that is not unusual. So wind power will work as a large component in energy with storage backup. But what is the Minister's estimate of the combined cost of wind power plus storage relative to other technologies?
Minister.
Well, he's quite right that wind energy is intermittent, and that's precisely why. I mean, he's proven the point. That's precisely why we need more storage solutions. As to the cost of that, I can tell you this. The cost of providing a sufficient level of storage will be far less expensive than the enormous cost of the Hinkley Point nuclear power station. Mr. McKenzie mentioned this. I mean, it's not eye-watering, it's almost unimaginable. It's £45,000 million. Let me just say that again.
Order, please.
£45,000 million. The granddaddy of them all. It dwarfs the total aggregate subsidy for renewable energy. Peter Atherton of Liberum Capital said that at £5 million per megawatt, the cost of the nuclear energy, which may someday be generated at Hinkley Point, the estimate at the moment is in the mid-220s. Peter Atherton said the cost is £5 million per megawatt, and he pointed out that the comparable cost of per megawatt of CCGT gas generation is £755,000. In other words, nuclear is seven times more expensive than gas. And Mr. Fraser's argument is that we should be saving money. It's almost unbelievable, Presiding Officer. In any event, I got sidetracked there because of Mr. Fraser. Let me just conclude my remarks, Presiding Officer, by emphasising we need more hydro. We need more solar, as Sarah Boyack and Lewis MacDonald quite rightly argue. We need more district heating schemes. And we've developed 33 projects with £7 million thus far, but we need to do far more in that regard. We need to devote more attention to developing our heat resources in Scotland. Not enough attention has been devoted to that. We need offshore wind. There are around 22 offshore wind schemes south of the border. There's not one here yet. It's time to even up the balance. We need more floating offshore wind, and I hope the Statoil project will be delivered quite soon. We also need a solution to the tremendous problems generated by the Conservatives' decision, which wasn't, as Mr. Fraser said, set out in the manifesto, to curtail without notice in that manifesto the ROCs system, which has undermined investment and which has led Ernst & Young to use language in criticising the Tory government, which is far more colourful, Presiding Officer, than anything that I could ever manage.
Many thanks. Our next item of business this afternoon is Stage 3 proceedings on the British Sign Language Scotland Bill. In dealing with amendments, members should have the bill as amended at Stage 2, that is SP Bill 55A revised, the marshalled list, that is SP Bill 55AML revised, the groupings, that is SP Bill 55AG revised, and the division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for 5 minutes for the first division of the afternoon. The period of voting for the first division will be 30 seconds, and thereafter I will allow a voting period of 1 minute for the first division after a debate. Members who wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible after I call the group. I would also ask members to note that we have interpreters in the chamber this afternoon, and therefore it would be helpful if speeches were delivered more slowly than usual. Can I now ask members to refer to the marshalled list of amendments, please? And I call Group 1, Status of British Sign Language, and I call Amendment 7 in the name of Mark Griffin in a group on its own, and I ask Mark Griffin to move and speak to Amendment 7, please, Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is a small amendment, but it's a significant amendment. It just removes one word from the bill. It removes the word sign from the bill because British Sign Language, while it is a sign language, it's a language in its own right. I think this amendment will give additional resonance and emphasis to the fact that BSL is a language in its own right. Throughout the progress of this bill, one of the clearest arguments put forward by witnesses in favour of the bill was that BSL should be recognised as such. I think this amendment will help to achieve that goal and make it clear to non-BSL users that BSL is a language and not simply a form of communication for a particular group. And I move Amendment 7 in my name.
Many thanks. Minister.
The Scottish Government clearly likewise regards British Sign Language as a language, and we confirmed this in a formal statement of recognition in 2011. In referring to British Sign Language simply as a language, rather than as originally written as a sign language, this amendment is consistent with our support for BSL, and therefore the Scottish Government is very happy to support this amendment.
Many thanks. Mark Griffin, do you wish to add anything further? And please indicate if you intend to press or withdraw.
If nothing further to add, just to press the amendment, Presiding Officer. Thank you.
Many thanks. In that case, the question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. That brings us to Group 2, BSL Translation of Progress Reports, and I call Amendment 1 in the name of the Minister, which is grouped with Amendments 2 and 3, and I ask the Minister to move Amendment 1, please, and speak to all of the amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mr Griffin lodged a series of amendments at Stage 2 requiring that both the BSL National Plan and Listed Authority BSL plans be translated into British Sign Language. The Scottish Government fully supported those amendments at the time. This amendment requires Scottish Ministers to translate the National Progress Report into British Sign Language. This means that the National Progress Report, which will be published every 6 years, will be accessible to British Sign Language users, who will naturally take very great interest in what progress is being made by national, regional and locally based public bodies. Amendments 2 and 3 are minor technical amendments which are necessary as a consequence of Amendment 1.
Many thanks. I call Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just very briefly to very much welcome the Minister's statement today and I think honouring a commitment, as he said, that he gave to the committee at Stage 2. This was an anomaly that I think we largely addressed through Mark Griffin's amendments at an earlier stage, but I very much welcome the further commitment he's been able to give.
Many thanks. Mark Griffin.
I welcome Amendment 1, which extends the requirement to make progress reports available in BSL in the same way as this has already been extended in relation to national plans and authority plans as a result of those earlier Stage 2 amendments mentioned by the Minister. I support Amendment 1 and Amendments 2 and 3, as the Minister says, they're of a minor nature. Thank you.
Thank you. Minister, to wind up, please.
Merely to formally move Amendment 1.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I now call Amendment 2 in the name of the Minister, which has already been debated with Amendment 1, and I ask the Minister to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I now call Amendment 3 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1, and ask the Minister to move formally, please.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. That then brings us to Group 3, Minor and Technical, and I call Amendment 4 in the name of the Minister, which is grouped with Amendments 5 and 6. And I ask the Minister to move Amendment 4, please, and speak to all of the amendments in the group.
In moving these amendments, I can confirm they are very minor tidying amendments as a result of the scale of amendments which were passed by the committee at Stage 2. Amendment 4 inserts into Section 8 some words which are necessary to make the provision read properly. Amendments 5 and 6 bring the long title into line with what the Bill provides for in relation to references to plans following those amendments at Stage 2.
Thank you, Minister. I call Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I note these minor amendments, which are of a tidy-up nature and also ensure consistency in references throughout the Bill as a result of Stage 2 amendments, and I'm happy to support these amendments in the name of the Minister.
Thank you. Minister, do you wish to wind up?
Merely to move Amendment 4.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. In which case I call Amendment 5 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 4, and ask the Minister to move formally, please.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I therefore call Amendment 6 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 4, and I ask the Minister to move formally, please.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. And that ends consideration of amendments, which then brings us to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 14111 in the name of Mark Griffin, on the British Sign Language Scotland Bill. And I would invite members who wish to speak in this debate to press the request to speak buttons now, please. And I call on Mark Griffin to speak to and move the motion. 10 minutes, please, Mr. Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's with great, great pleasure that I open today's debate. The bill was introduced to Parliament on the 29th of October 2014 and concluded Stage 1 with a parliamentary debate on the 5th of May 2015. The Education and Culture Committee considered the bill at Stage 2 on the 2nd of June, and today the Parliament debates whether to pass the bill. I very much hope that members will come together in welcoming this legislation and support the bill at decision time. Now, before I go on to discuss the main amendments to the bill that were agreed at Stage 2, I'd like to put on record my thanks to a number of people who have helped shape and develop the bill. In particular, I'd like to thank the Education and Culture Committee for its considered scrutiny of the bill and for its continued engagement with members of the deaf community by giving them the means to participate in the progress of the bill. I think the Education and Culture Committee's processes in enabling as many people to participate as possible, I think, is an exemplar for the Parliament. My thanks also go to members of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee for its continued scrutiny of the subordinate legislation powers, and to those people who have worked so hard to support me in the bill prior to its introduction and through its parliamentary stages. I would also like to express my gratitude for the positive and constructive way in which the Minister for Learning, Science and Scotland Languages, Dr Allen, and his officials have approached the bill. Presiding Officer, I would also like to thank you and your office for the support of your staff in the Bills Unit for doing a lot of the heavy lifting in terms of developing the bill and accompanying documents. They really have been a tremendous support, and I would also like to thank you personally, while you're clearly impartial today, for the support the Presiding Officers as a whole have given in terms of the corporate body translating a large volume of documents into BSL videos. Without that support, it just would not have been possible to make the bill process as inclusive as it rightly was. Now, finally, I would like to thank members of the cross-party group on deafness, many of whom are in the chamber today. This bill marks almost a decade of their hard work. This bill is a fantastic advert for our Parliament in terms of its openness and accessibility. It's a fantastic example of a minority group in our society coming together, forming a cross-party group, setting out its priorities and lobbying members to the point we have a bill which is here in front of us today. Because of their dedication, I think it's only right and proper that we show our appreciation and thanks for them. As I said, there have been a number of changes made to the bill since I last stood in the chamber at stage one. These changes are the result of a lot of joint working with the Scottish Government and valuable contributions from stakeholders such as Deafblind Scotland. But one thing that hasn't changed is the aim of the bill. As I explained at stage one, British Sign Language is the first language and only language of many deaf people in Scotland. BSL is a visual gestural language that uses space and movement. The hands, face and head are used to communicate, and it has a different grammatical structure from English. But across Scotland, BSL is the Indigenous manual language in the same way as English is the Indigenous spoken language. Deaf people who use BSL are part of a recognised cultural and linguistic minority, and unlike people who speak other minority languages, many deaf sign language users can't learn to speak English as they can't hear the language. The aim of my bill has been to encourage the use of BSL in Scottish public life and raise awareness of the language amongst the hearing population, and I'm confident that it's in good shape to achieve these aims. During the stage one process, the Education and Culture Committee heard evidence from witnesses who gave examples of how a lack of BSL awareness and skills among members of the hearing population affected their everyday lives. And I'd like to tell you about another case which is included in the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman's annual report. It's a woman who communicates through BSL was admitted to hospital for surgery. During her 12-day stay in hospital, 12 whole days, although hospital staff tried to communicate with her, they didn't provide her with a BSL interpreter. That was despite the woman repeatedly pointing to a poster for interpreter services and twice handing staff a BSL interpreter's card. It was clear from the hospital records that she felt isolated because of the lack of communication. That's just one example that has been published by the Ombudsman. We also heard statistics provided by the Scottish Council on Deafness, who found that 77% of BSL users who had visited hospital couldn't easily communicate with NHS staff. And it's that sense of abandonment and isolation, whether it be in a healthcare situation, in a school, an education situation, that I hope the passing of this legislation will address. And I'd like to focus on some of the key changes that have come about from the stage two consideration of the bill, and firstly the scope of the National Plan for Scotland. The amendments which have been made in this area, lodged by the Minister, reduced the total number of plans by bringing a number of other public bodies within the scope of the National Plan. That gives greater clarity, I think, about the purpose of the National Plan and will reduce that administrative burden on the public sector. At the same time, a number of bodies were added to the schedule, which means the Scottish Government are able to take a more strategic, coordinated approach to BSL at a national level. On planning and reporting, the amendments that have been made in that area create a fixed cycle for the production of plans and progress reports. Now, when I first considered the timing of plans, it was my intention that national plans should be linked to each cycle of Parliament, so that every government would produce their own plan and review their own plan. But I accepted the Minister's argument that a fixed-term cycle is much more predictable, it's simpler, and that a parliamentary cycle is potentially unhelpful for local authorities who operate on a different cycle. The bill I instructed also referred to performance reviews, which would highlight good and poor practice and name and shame those authorities who were falling short. And I was persuaded that the Minister's approach to replace this with a progress report that will identify progress with authority plans through a self-assessment process involving feedback from BSL users made sense. I would also like to thank Dennis Robertson for his continued keen interest in the bill. Dennis and I lodged some amendments that will guarantee the inclusion of people who are deafblind in the implementation of the bill. Firstly, a new section to the bill now means that references to BSL and the bill are in the main, both the visual form and the tactile form of the language. When we originally drafted the bill, we took the view that the term BSL covered all forms of BSL, but I was happy to amend the bill to deliver this clarity. Certainly give way to Mr. Stewart.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Could I put on record my thanks to Mr. Griffin and to Mr. Robertson for these changes which will benefit the deafblind community. Having talked to some of my own constituents who are deafblind, this is immensely advantageous to them, and I'd like to thank Mr. Griffin and Mr. Robertson for their efforts on that front.
Mark Griffin.
Thank Mr. Stewart for those kind words. I think it just shows how mobilised and ambitious and enthusiastic the deaf and deafblind community are about this bill, that I think most MSPs had communication on this particular amendment, and it was great that we were able to do something about it. Those changes have been made so that tactile BSL is specifically included. There was also a change around ministerial responsibility. The bill included a section on the Scottish Government identifying a specific minister, but I'm happy that the Government operates on the basis of collective responsibility, and I've indicated that they will identify Dr. Allen as the lead minister and point of contact for anyone wishing to engage with BSL. Now, the Stage 2 process, along with today's final amendments, mean that the bill is now in good shape to start delivering real, tangible change for BSL users in Scotland. Presiding Officer, I'm delighted to move the motion in my name that Parliament agrees that the British Sign Language Scotland Bill be passed. Thank you.
Many thanks, and I now call on Dr. Alistair Allen, Minister, 7 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and to the many in the gallery, can I simply say thank you and welcome to the Scottish Parliament. I had the privilege of meeting with a few of our deaf-blind visitors, and deaf and deaf-blind visitors, just before today's debate, and I know that many of you have campaigned for a British Sign Language Bill for many years, and I recognise that this is a significant day for that community. But I would also like to congratulate Mark Griffin for proposing this bill, and I want to thank him likewise for working with the Scottish Government so closely over the past few months to help, I think, together improve the bill's provisions. Now, the bill has enjoyed cross-party support throughout its parliamentary progress. Indeed, all of the amendments at Stage 2 were supported by Mr. Griffin and by all members of the Education and Culture Committee. As Mr. Griffin has said, the aim of the bill is to promote the use and understanding of BSL across the Scottish public sector. The clear intention is that over time, this will improve the way we understand and respond to the needs of our deaf and deaf-blind citizens who, as has been mentioned, use BSL as a first language. But, Presiding Officer, it is more than that. Too often, perhaps, we talk about BSL users only as recipients of our public services. Instead, I want to pay tribute to the resilience and creativity of the deaf community in Scotland, and I would suggest that we will all benefit, all of us in Scotland, from their contribution to our country and to our economy. The bill before us today requires Scottish ministers to publish a BSL national plan within 2 years of the Act receiving royal assent, listed authorities, including local authorities and regional NHS boards, will have to publish their own BSL plans a year later. And we will be required to publish a national progress report, which will highlight progress, best practice and areas for improvement across the entire public sector, which subsequent BSL plans will need to address. BSL plans and reports will be published every 6 years, meaning that we will be able to see real progress over time. As a result of our amendments, the BSL National Plan will cover all public bodies with a national remit who are directly accountable to Scottish ministers. We think this will enable a more coordinated, strategic approach at a national level. It will also significantly reduce the number of plans being produced, which will reduce the administrative burden and the cost on the Scottish public sector. I am determined, Presiding Officer, to ensure that the Bill, if passed, will help us to take the practical steps which will make a real, tangible difference to the day-to-day lives of our citizens who use BSL, and to their families and to their communities. It is, therefore, crucial that the national and local BSL plans properly reflect their priorities. So we intend to establish a BSL National Advisory Group, which will advise Scottish ministers on the content of the National Plan. The group will include a significant proportion of deaf BSL users. The BSL National Advisory Group will draw on the views of the wider deaf and deafblind community and will develop a set of priorities to be included in that National Plan. We also want to share expertise and resources to help public bodies to improve their understanding of and response to the deaf communities they serve. This year, we have provided funding of £415,000 to 5 deaf organisations to help make that happen. Working with the British Deaf Association, the Scottish Council on Deafness, Deaf Action, Deaf Connections and Deaf Blind Scotland, we have created the Deaf Sector Partnership. And the most important function of the partnership will be to support proper engagement between public bodies and the BSL communities that they serve. It is this engagement which will help to ensure that the plans focus on the right things, and in doing so, make a real practical difference to people's lives. So I look forward to sharing more detail on this programme of work in due course. But before I finish, I want to make it clear that the Scottish Government recognises deafness as a culture and British Sign Language as a language. We recognised and formalised this in a statement of recognition in 2011, and I quote from it. The Scottish Government recognises the importance of British Sign Language to the deaf community in Scotland, and the contribution which this vibrant language makes to the rich and varied use of language in Scotland today. British Sign Language is a vital means of communication for deaf people, as well as a part of their linguistic and cultural identity. It is my view, Presiding Officer, that if we promote, protect, support and value British Sign Language and deaf culture, we will all of us benefit from the greater contribution which deaf and deafblind citizens can and want to make to our communities, to our country and to our economy. In doing so, it will contribute too to our wider efforts to create a fairer Scotland. And in saying that, I commend this bill to Parliament.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Rhoda Grant. 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I firstly congratulate Mark Griffin in bringing forward this bill? It requires hard work and determination to bring a bill through the Parliament, and he has just done that. I hope that the whole Parliament will support the bill, passing it into legislation tonight. It will send a strong message to the deaf and deafblind community that we value them and that we value their language. BSL is the main language used by people born deaf or deafblind, and it can also be used by people who have become deaf later in life. And the bill highlights that BSL is a language in its own right. Like any other language, it's used to pass down culture and history through the generations. The rich and famous have their history and culture written down in history books for them, while the masses are dependent on their stories being handed down through generations. Language is hugely important in that process, which is why we value our languages that are used by all our communities. And indeed, we need to take steps to preserve and promote them, promoting with them the culture and history of our people. The bill will bring a focus on BSL. The requirement for plans will make public bodies and government think through their policy with regard to promoting and protecting the language. And there's a number of issues that the bill will help to address. Making BSL more accessible will have an impact on school attainment. We've heard before that deaf children have a lower attainment than hearing children. And that's a built-in inequality that we must tackle to ensure that all young people reach their full potential. As people progress through school, language becomes technical, especially in the STEM subjects, where we really need to encourage young people to participate. And to increase attainment, we need to make sure that BSL is available to young people in school, that the signer has adequate knowledge of the subject to translate it back to the pupil in a way that will allow them to attain the same as hearing pupils in the school. And I think it would also be useful if BSL, like other languages, was available as part of the school curriculum, that young people who don't require it to communicate would learn it and be able to communicate with deaf and deafblind people and indeed enrich their lives through that learning. We also need to look at rolling out more BSL training, and I'd like to pay tribute to Trade Union Learning that have done a huge amount of work in this respect, and I undertook a short course through Trade Union Learning in BSL, and sadly, because I haven't been using it, I would have to say that the knowledge I learned has been pretty sketchy. I think it's really important that we continue to learn, but also have the opportunity to use skills gained through language courses to make sure that we continue to use it, because Trade Union Learning were really keen that people in the public sector, in the service industries, had those skills to enable them to better communicate with their clients. In Scotland, 90% of deaf children are born to hearing parents, and that indicates a real need for BSL for families and adult learnings. For parents to be able to communicate effectively with their children, it requires them to learn the language before their children in order to help them develop skills. And therefore, this learning needs to take place immediately deafness is identified in a child. Promotion of the language will also ensure that many professionals learn to speak the language. And one of the big issues for BSL users is access to services. And there's times that this can be an inconvenience, but there are other times where it's detrimental. Take example, access to health. And Mark Griffin told us about some awful stories there. We're all nervous about going to hospital, but how much so if you're so isolated? But it also interferes with the need for confidentiality, because that's compromised through a translator. And that becomes even more difficult for people with mental health issues who need to be able to explain their thoughts and feelings to medical professionals. And the use of an interpreter can be a barrier to that. So it's vital that people undertaking that role understand the issues involved and are able to put them across to health professionals. Presiding Officer, this bill highlights BSL as a language in its own right, a language to pass on history and culture, a language to communicate, to build relationships, and indeed a language for fun. Isolation can be devastating, and if BSL were more widely used and understood, it would tackle isolation. It would also give hearing users access to another language with its rich heritage and culture. I want to thank and congratulate Mark Griffin again for bringing forward this legislation. This Parliament has passed many pieces of legislation that make us all proud. This bill will be another great example of that, and I hope we can all support it tonight.
Many thanks, and I now call on Murdo Fraser. 5 minutes or so, please. Oh, sorry. Mary Scanlon, I seem to have the wrong script. 5 minutes or so, please.
I've never been taken for Murdo Fraser before, but it's always a first. I would also like to thank Mark Griffin for successfully steering this bill to its final stages in this Parliament. I commend his commitment, which I understand was based on family experiences. And at this final stage, I think it's also worth commending Cathy Craigie, former Labour MSP, and more recently Jenny Mara, for their excellent work on behalf of deaf people in Scotland. The Scottish Conservatives fully support the measures in this bill, and we will be voting 100% for this bill at 5 o'clock tonight. We also support any measures to assist deaf people and their families to communicate effectively. The bill will make a difference in promoting and raising awareness of BSL, as well as keeping the issue on the political agenda, and it's undoubtedly a step in the right direction. The word postcode provision is often used in relation to BSL, and I fully agree with Inclusion Scotland when they ask for an honest appraisal of where the gaps in provision exist and how these will be addressed during the period of the plan. Accurate baseline data is essential for the bill in order to achieve the success we all hope for. One fact is that Inclusion Scotland state that there are 30 qualified BSL interpreters here in Scotland, and the National Deaf Children's Society say there are 80. So that's an example of two organisations well versed in this issue that disagree with the number of interpreters. So unless accurate figures are assured from the start, then any progress measures are meaningless. And on the subject of postcode lottery, there's one place that qualifies as a centre of excellence, and that is Dingwall Academy in the Highlands. And I'm very pleased to welcome Margaret Kinsman and the pupils to the gallery today, along with so many other people in Scotland who have joined this Parliament to see this bill going through. I met teaching staff at Dingwall Academy earlier this year, and I have to say I was inspired by their enthusiasm and commitment to extending BSL to pupils. And I make no apology for bringing forward what they want done after today. Every single pupil in first year at Dingwall Academy gets 16 hours of BSL. Every pupil. I'm not sure if Dingwall is the only secondary school in Scotland to offer all S1 pupils BSL, but I can ask if any MSP can give a local example to match Dingwall or do better than Dingwall, then I'd be pleased to hear about it. So whilst we fully support and welcome all the progress today in today's bill, there's still more to do. It is disappointing that there's no formal qualification to National 4 or 5 in Scotland. And given that the Scottish Government always like comparisons with England, I can say that in England, a GCSE has been developed in BSL, and it's being piloted in 5 schools and 1 college starting this month. So given the equivalence between GCSE and the national exams, I hope that the Scottish Government will now work with English authorities with a view to bringing BSL into parity with qualifications for other languages. And I've been asked by Dingwall Academy that they would quite like to be one of the first when a pilot comes forward, Minister. And I don't mind waiting until you sum up for you to give this guarantee, Minister. A reason often given for a lack of BSL teaching and support is the lack of teachers. And I think that the Scottish Government could be looking at how to incentivise teachers to take up training and qualifications. I didn't realise that currently a teaching qualification is needed, then 3 years of teaching experience, followed by another 2 years of distance learning through Murray House in Edinburgh. So I understand that most local authorities will fund around 85% of fees and, of course, allow time off, but this is still a huge commitment for any individual to do this course of training, given that there's no pay enhancement at the end of study for teaching BSL. My 5 minutes is up. I'm summing up, so I'll finish off the rest of my speech later. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I do have a little bit of time in hand, so as we turn to the open debate, speeches of 5 minutes, please. And I call Dennis Robertson to be followed by Cara Hilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I welcome all our guests to the gallery this afternoon, Presiding Officer, and to those in the overspill room. I'm not sure when last this Parliament had to use an overspill room when we were debating in this chamber. It gives me great pleasure to thank Mark Griffin for bringing this forward. Rura Grant said it's a proud moment, and I sincerely hope Mr. Griffin will have that sense of pride come 5 o'clock when his bill is passed. Can I also thank Mark Griffin and my friend and colleague Kevin Stewart for acknowledging the very small part I played in this particular bill at stage two. Small, but very important. Important to the deafblind community, a community who wishes to have the same equality as everyone else. And to have tactile BSL to be recognised within this bill is a journey that they have been on for so long. And I probably would like to offer my sincere thanks to Drina O'Malley. And it's not often I would say that, Presiding Officer, having worked with Drina O'Malley probably for the last 30 years or so in different sensory services, I can assure you. But Drina's hard work, determination, enthusiasm, energy has actually helped in steering this and bringing this a acknowledgement of tactile BSL. And I thank her and everyone else within Deafblind Scotland. I want to sort of look at the raising the awareness aspect and what it does mean. Presiding Officer, prior to being elected, I had the great privilege to be the service manager for North East Sanitary Services. And that included providing services for blind, people who are deaf, hard of hearing, and deaf-blind. And at that time, when we were awarded the contract to provide services for those who were deaf and deaf-blind, we had a staff group who had little knowledge apart from those who had been two-paid over from a different organisation. But the majority of our staff group had no awareness of BSL. When we asked staff to come forward to learn BSL, we were absolutely astounded. Every single member of staff came forward. Everyone wanted to embrace that stage one acknowledgement on BSL so they could be at the front line. So if any person who required BSL that came into the services, whether it be in Aberdeen or Moray, came in, they would at least face someone who could acknowledge their language and their wants, their needs, their requirements. And that's all people ask for, Presiding Officer. People in the deaf community just want to be the same as everyone else. They want to be able to communicate and to be understood. Now, the Scottish Government haven't sat back and done nothing over the years, and indeed, I think, in some respects, the work that has gone on within the cross-party group, and I thank Mark Griffin for his kind comments on the cross-party group, and Jenny Mara is convener of that, and I'm one of the co-conveners, we are under a great deal of, I think, I was going to say pressure, but it's not pressure. it's a great deal of understanding and sort of taking forward the needs and the wants of the people who recognise that they have a different need, a need that needs to be recognised. And the point I want to make is that we have moved forward and we've embraced technology. And one of the examples can I give with the technology, because I know my time's running out, Presiding Officer, is the video relay system. Now, the video relay system is there, and initially it was with NHS 24, but it's now been rolled out to all public services with additional funding from the government. This enables people who use BSL to be able to communicate same as anyone else. When they go to their, if they want to make an appointment with a GP, or they go to any other public service, they've got an app on their phone, smart technology, all those things are available. And the chief officer from the Scottish Council of Deafness, when this was rolled out, said it was terrific. Terrific, presiding officer. Because she said it gave people using BSL the confidence and the confidentiality to speak and to be heard the same as everyone else. Presiding officer, my time is up. But can I say that when I looked at the National Advisory Group, I saw three initials, N-A-G, NAG. I sincerely hope the advisory group continue to nag the government.
Thank you very much. And I now call Cara Hilton to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. May I begin by paying tribute to my colleague Mark Griffin for his tireless work in promoting this bill and progressing the welfare, culture and values of the deaf community right across Scotland. I'd also like to welcome all the guests to the gallery today. This bill presents us with an opportunity to drive an important culture change in society's attitude to BSL. I followed the bill with interest from its early stages and noted some of the comments from stakeholders that the bill was unnecessary as the Equality Act. Yep, very early.
Dennis Robertson.
Can I maybe just say to the member, the member will acknowledge we have signers in the gallery, and one of the aspects of being able to sign to ensure that all your words are passed over to those in our gallery and those watching, obviously, in video, is perhaps the speed of presentation. Thank you.
Apologies there. I speak very fast. I think it's a Grangemouth thing. I think as we're all too aware, there's been very limited progress in securing equal rights, and that's why we're here debating the bill today. The importance of this bill is that it does not treat British Sign Language as an aid of those perceived as being disabled. It gives BSL its correct status as a fully independent and Indigenous language of Scotland with its own culture, grammar and history. And at the bill's heart is the aspiration to drive real change for deaf children, their families and all BSL users in Scotland. Turning to the provisions of the bill, I hope that the requirement for both the Scottish Government and public bodies to draft British Sign Language action plans will ensure increased support for deaf people, particularly for young people and children still in the education system. This is important because the National Deaf Children's Society estimates that there are as many as 3,850 deaf children in Scotland, and every year 120 children are born with severe or profound hearing loss. And figures show that a very worrying attainment gap between deaf children and their peers. Scottish Government figures reveal that only just over a third of deaf pupils attain hires or advanced hires compared to 60% of hearing pupils. And in 2012, almost 10% of deaf school leavers left with no qualifications at SCQF 2 or above, compared to just 2% of all pupils. This discrepancy is unacceptable, and it leaves many deaf young people struggling to find a decent college place or university place or to access job opportunities. But it's not just about qualifications. The BDA, in their evidence to the Education Committee, highlighted how reliance on interpreters in the classroom means that deaf children are often unable to be fully engaged with classroom activities, including the natural jokes and banter of the classroom environment. This leaves many feeling bored and socially isolated at school, and this is obviously going to have a lasting effect on children's mental health. As the Children's Commissioner Tam Bailey pointed out in his briefing for today's debate, the failure of our education system to fully meet the needs of children who use BSL as their main language is not only a lost opportunity for those children, it's a denial of their basic human rights. So the provision of national and local BSL action plans provides an opportunity for us to set goals and priorities to deal with those issues, to address the attainment gap and prevent deaf children from being left behind by our education system. In their submission to the Education Committee, the BDAA also highlighted the poor level of knowledge amongst some teachers and interpreters using BSL in the schools. Many of those professionals have qualifications in BSL no greater than a higher. So I welcome the opportunity the Bill offers to set more rigorous targets for the training and monitoring of BSL used by teachers and school interpreters. And I hope too that we will see BSL becoming part of the school curriculum. As Rhoda Grant has already highlighted, 90% of deaf children have hearing parents, and many report difficulties in adjusting to a child's diagnosis and a struggle to find the resources to help the children communicate. So again, I welcome the steps being taken by some local authorities to provide home visits from BSL interpreters, working with parents from a very early age to encourage linguistic development, rather than wait until the children start school. Yet again, this support can be patchy, and our recent survey of parents across Scotland found that a worrying 35% had received no information about using BSL with their child before they started school. So there must be more done to ensure local authorities share best practice as they develop their local action plans. I hope too there will be more investment from the Scottish Government to address the current gaps in delivery and deliver real change. And this is especially important in closing the attainment gap. To conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, today is an historic moment for the deaf community in Scotland. The Bill sends out a really important message to those who use BSL that their language and culture is valued, that their rights are recognised, and it will help raise and increase awareness of BSL across the hearing population too. This is a bill that really will transform lives of every British Sign Language user in Scotland. I would like to thank Mark Griffin once more for his tremendous work in bringing this bill through Parliament, and I hope and trust that we'll have the unanimous support of members today.
Thank you very much, and I now call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Stuart Maxwell.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I, as I did at stage one, start by thanking all those who helped the Education Committee in our scrutiny of this bill, particularly the BSL users and people from the deaf community who took time to give evidence. Thanks too to those who helped us break all previous records, attendance records, at the Education Committee, many of whom are in the gallery this afternoon, including the representatives of Dingwall Academy. And can I wish Mary Scanlon well in her campaign, presumably to become director or rector of Dingwall Academy once she retires from this place. But of course, I offer sincere congratulations to Mark Griffin on his work alongside the Minister in delivering for the BSL community. While this bill will not in itself deliver early improvements in access to services, better educational outcomes, or the removal of barriers to employment, it does, however, hold out the very real possibility of accelerating a cultural and attitudinal change that makes those changes more likely, more quickly in the future. By increasing recognition of BSL as an Indigenous language that has its own culture and identity, as the Minister remarked, we can pave the way for ensuring that deaf people are able to access information and services in their first language. Despite overwhelming support for Mr. Griffin's bill, concerns were raised with us. Partly this related to the potential risk of expectations being raised unfairly, and I think we had some sympathy with this. To a large extent, the BSL community have shown themselves to be very well aware of what the bill would and would not achieve. But there is the potential for misunderstanding. There was also an argument that the bill's aims are already covered elsewhere, notably by equality legislation. I think we were right to reject this assertion, as it fundamentally misses the point that equality legislation will do nothing to promote BSL as a standalone language. That said, I think we did succeed in making a number of important improvements to the bill, reflecting some very genuine concerns and sensible suggestions put forward by those from whom we took evidence. The way in which national and local authority plans will be developed is, I believe, more pragmatic and meaningful as a result of changes that have been made to the bill as first introduced. There was always a balance to strike between ensuring transparency and accountability on the one hand, while on the other, not drowning councils, public bodies and others in costly reporting requirements that would do little for the BSL community. Again, I think the bill now better reflects that proper balance. The content of the plans will be developed over time, but we know from the evidence we received that they will need to prioritise promotion of BSL in education settings, including in early years support, as well as opening up access to healthcare and employment opportunities. It is right that ministers should be required to keep Parliament updated on progress, not as a means of naming and shaming, but to ensure that the bill is actually doing what we intend it to do and identifying, along with the work of the advisory group, potential areas where changes and improvements might need to be made. That advisory group, as I said at stage one, should be drawn in the main from the BSL community itself. Two other changes which I would like briefly to highlight fall into the category, I think, of the painfully obvious, yet for various reasons they were not explicit in the original bill. The first relates to the need for specific recognition of the distinct needs of the deafblind community. I know this was something that Mark Griffin himself was keen to see, but it also came through strongly during our evidence session, and it's something the Law Society also drew attention to. I'm delighted that this initial weakness in the bill has now been addressed, thanks to the efforts of Mark Griffin and indeed of Dennis Robertson. The other area relates to the availability of the plans being produced in BSL. Frankly, it was utterly inconceivable that this would not be the case, but nevertheless, again, it was something that needed to be strengthened at stage two, and I very much welcome the further improvements that have been made earlier this afternoon at stage three. Deputy Presiding Officer, I think the final comment I would make about this bill is the impact it has had on Parliament itself. I referred earlier to the committee meetings where we struggled to accommodate all those who wished to attend, not a regular challenge that we are forced to confront. But I think this reflects the inclusive way in which we've gone about engaging with those most directly affected by the legislation we are scrutinising. That is how it should be, even if it is not always as it is. I therefore pay tribute to the committee clerks and the other parliamentary staff for the creativity and dedication they have shown to this task. I think they can be rightly proud of what they have been able to achieve, not just in relation to the passage of this bill, but for the way, I hope, it influences the manner in which we operate more generally and more accessibly in future. Presiding Officer, as I said at stage one, this bill can and will help raise the profile of BSL as a distinct language and, over time, increase its use in delivery of services. For that, committee colleagues, the Minister, but most of all, Mark Griffin, deserve great, great credit. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Stuart Maxwell.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I begin, like many others, in offering my sincerest congratulations to Mark Griffin. For those of us who have experienced trying to take a bill through this place, we understand and sympathise with any other member who is going through the difficult process of trying to take a bill through Parliament as an individual member. To have achieved not only to get the bill partway through and supported by the government, but to get your own bill all the way through to stage three is a tremendous achievement, and you should be very proud of what you have done. Can I also thank all of those who gave evidence to the committee? They really helped the committee in its examination of the bill. I want to thank in particular my fellow committee members, but one of the problems, Presiding Officer, of speaking after fellow committee members, both Mary Scanlon and Liam MacArthur, is effectively they cover the detail of the bill and many of the things that you wanted to say. But can I just, in genuine appreciation of their work in their efforts throughout the process, but also can I echo what they have said today in the comments about the bill? Now, I hope that the actions taken by the committee and indeed the Parliament to ensure that as many people as possible from both the deaf and the deaf-blind communities could fully engage with the committee and the Parliament have made a genuine difference. Now, I'm sure, like others, I was lobbied by deaf and deaf-blind constituents, and I think Not only was that a tremendously important part of the process of my understanding the need and the importance of the bill, but it also made very clear to me in a very stark way the difficulties that individual members of the deaf and deafblind community face on a daily basis. I'll give you one example. A deaf constituent approached me and attempted to make an appointment to come and see me to talk about both the bill and also issues that he wanted to talk about personally. I could have seen him very quickly that week, in fact. The problem was getting a BSL interpreter to be available on the day that he and I were both available. So instead of being able to meet that constituent within a few days or a week, it took many, many weeks to actually arrange the appointment where three people could sit down so that we could actually speak to each other and understand each other and make sure that that constituent got their points across and that their view was recognised in the work that I was doing in Parliament.
Dennis Robertson.
I thank you, Presiding Officer, and Mr Maxwell. With the new video relay system that has been rolled out to more public services, does the member feel that this would avoid any further delay in actually making appointments with constituents?
Well, Mr Maxwell.
I think Dennis Robertson makes an extremely important point. I think the use of technology, and we have been talking about it in the committee, the use of technology will be an extremely important way of ensuring that deaf members of the community, deaf constituents, deaf-blind constituents can indeed get in touch very quickly with their own MSPs and I'm sure MPs and ensure that they get their voice heard. And I'd be very interested to hear the detail of that particular rollout of that programme. Now, I'm going to do something now that doesn't often get done in this Parliament. I'm going to blow our own trumpet. And now, I'm sure that what the Education Committee did wasn't perfect by any means, but I believe it was a substantial step forward in the way this Parliament operates. We in the Education and Culture Committee created a BSL Facebook group, and we invited the BSL community to join and share their views on the bill, posting BSL video clips. The group was extremely well received, and it attracted some 2,400 members who posted simply hundreds of BSL videos and comments relating to the bill. And I think that was a tremendous step forward. We also translated key documents into BSL, including our call for views and guidance on how we handle submissions, summaries of the evidence received, and our Stage 1 report. We adopted a bilingual approach to the committee's public meetings, and we invited witnesses to give evidence in BSL and provided English BSL interpretation for the public gallery and via Parliament TV. And to accompany the launch of our Stage 1 report, we filmed a Q&A session involving some BSL users who had given evidence to the committee. And that video was posted on our website and various social media to offer deaf people an alternative means of finding out what the committee had included in its report. I think that was a tremendous step forward, and I again want to echo the comments of Liam MacArthur to thank those in the Parliament who did all the hard work in making sure that we could achieve that. Now, I think a number of benefits came from that. In fact, the committee initiatives, were particularly the Facebook group, were widely held up as good examples of how public bodies could be inclusive, and the feedback we got was indeed very good for those in the BSL community who engaged with that process. Presiding Officer, expectations are high amongst many of what this bill can deliver. We all hope that these expectations will be met and that much can be achieved through the recognition and the long overdue promotion of BSL. I want to quote from the very beginning of the bill, "An act of the Scottish Parliament to promote the use of British Sign Language, including by making provisions for the preparation and publication of national plans in relation to British Sign Language." Many people have waited a long, long time to see those words on an act of the Scottish Parliament. Presiding Officer, Scotland has many languages and indeed many cultures, and I am delighted that we are taking this vital step today in putting BSL on an equal footing to the other languages of Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to the wind-up speeches, and I call Mary Scanlon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Stuart Maxwell mentioned expectations, and I think that's what this bill is all about. If we look at the expectations of deaf children and adults, but if we also add on our expectations in the Education Committee on and the work we're doing on attainment. And that takes me back to Dingwall. Dingwall Academy is rightly proud of their pupils in recent years, and I have to say I saw no limits to their expectations, with one profoundly deaf pupil becoming a maths teacher, another becoming an audiologist, two other profoundly deaf pupils now at university, and a third graduated with first class honours last year, and various other ex-pupils at college in the Highlands. And I think this is what the bill is all about. It's about bringing deaf children on a level footing and giving them the same opportunities and career opportunities as all other children. And sorry. And a hearing pupil who studied BSL and deaf studies at Dingwall has now gone on to be an interpreter, graduating with first class honours. And so I see no limit, given that deaf children are given the proper support when they need it. The focus on progress reports against the published performance plan is commendable, and I hope that those who make progress, but from a very low base, will realise just how much progress is still required. And I also hope that where provision is good, that they will continue to make improvements and make progress in terms of providing BSL. Conservatives also welcome the setting up of a national advisory board to support the implementation of the bill, and I hope they will adhere to the principles and the hopes contained in the bill. So, Presiding Officer, my final issue is one that I've raised at every opportunity since the commencement of the bill, and I have to say it was raised again by Dingwall Academy today, and that is the proposal to improve the availability of family sign language, to enhance the ability of hearing parents to communicate with their deaf children and help promote their development. Helping the child and also helping families must be such a positive way forward, given that 90% of deaf children are born to hearing parents. I did not know that prior to looking at this bill. So when it comes to postcode provision, this service certainly fits. I understand there is an early years project by the National Deaf Children's Society, but there is still much that Scottish Government could do in future to ensure that all families are given the support they need just to communicate with their own children. Not much to ask. And I think Rhoda Grant made the point that it should be at the point of diagnosis, not when they start school or when they go to secondary school. According to NDCS, and I quote, there is currently no nationally funded provision for those parents to access training or classes in order to communicate with their child through sign language, suggesting that family provision needs to include signs and phrases to facilitate play and child-centred activities, so the appropriate support for families, particularly birth to preschool. The family sign language improves vocabulary for deaf children, but it also contributes so positively to family relationships. I can't imagine, as a parent, what it could be like not to communicate with a child, and I think we should all think of that. So I would like to see family sign language included in the progress reports and the performance reviews in future, and I ask the Minister if that's a consideration that he will take on board for future. So I very much welcome this bill, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Conservatives support every word in the bill, but we're also looking for more, and I once again commend Mark Griffin and give my party's full support to this bill. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Siobhan McMahon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It gives me great pleasure to close the debate for Scottish Labour today. I'd like to start by congratulating my colleague Mark Griffin on bringing this bill to the Chamber and for giving the deaf community a voice in Parliament. I know that the bill means a lot to Mark, and that is evident from the effort he has given to this bill throughout its entire process. I'd also like to pay tribute to Cathy Craigie for her work in this area. Mark and I share a regional office, and I know of the hard work he and the staff Cathy, and in particular Frank, have dedicated to this bill. I'm so pleased that this will be recognised at 5 p.m. tonight, when this Parliament, hopefully, unites to pass this historic bill. It's a great privilege for me to be part of today's debate. As a member of the Education and Cultural Committee at the time we were scrutinising this bill, I have heard first-hand evidence as to why we require this bill and what impact it is likely to have on people's life if it fulfils its potential. As Heather Gray, Director of the National Deaf Children's Society, said, the British Sign Language Scotland Bill marks a historic moment for the deaf community in Scotland, many of whom have British Sign Language as their first or preferred language. The National Deaf Children's Society strongly believes that if implemented, this landmark legislation will become a key driver in Scotland towards more effective service provision, better opportunities and improved life chances for deaf children and young people. However, we must not rest on our laurels. When I spoke in the debate at Stage 1, I highlighted a number of issues facing deaf people in Scotland today. I don't want to go through each of them again today, however, I believe it is important to draw the Chamber's attention to the attainment gap currently faced by deaf learners, which is extremely concerning. Scottish Government figures for 2011-12 show that 36.4% of deaf pupils attained hires or advanced hires, compared to 60.2% of hearing pupils. Scottish Government data also shows that only 26% of deaf school leavers are likely to go on to higher education, compared to 39% of hearing school leavers. We also know from the Grimes report that only 8% of teachers of the deaf can sign. We must address this, and I hope that the forthcoming report from the Education Committee on the attainment gap for those with a sensory impairment is looked at closely by the Scottish Government, and that all issues highlighted will be addressed as a matter of urgency. Statistics from the Scottish Council of Deafness show that up to 70% of deaf people believe they have failed to get a job because of their deafness. This is a sobering statistic, but one that has become all too familiar. In June of this year, I had the honour of sponsoring the Action on Hearing Loss reception, which a vast number of MSPs attended. The reception was to highlight Deaf Awareness Week and to recognise the importance for everyone to receive deaf awareness training and learn about the communication needs of the 850,000 people across Scotland. At that event, we heard from Abigail Matheson about her experience of trying to gain employment. Abigail said at that time that employers' lack of understanding of communication support, poor deaf awareness and not knowing about the Access to Work scheme are creating barriers preventing deaf people from having the chance to get into their preferred careers. Abigail also raised the problems deaf people often face at Job Centre Plus, where staff won't always book British Sign Language interpreters or use the correct terminology when talking about the deaf community and their individual communication needs. We must do more to help those like Abigail get the support they require to enter the workplace. It is true that this bill will address some of the problems Abigail outlined, but it won't address them all. It has been made clear by Mark Griffin and organisations supporting this bill that this bill is the first step on the journey to improve the lives of deaf people in Scotland. This bill will not solve all the problems deaf people currently face, but it is an important first step that this Parliament must take today. As we heard in evidence, this bill will give deaf people the opportunity to access life through their own language. There could be no stronger point to end on. I look forward to supporting this bill at decision time tonight.
Thank you. I now call Dr. Alistair Allen. Minister, you've got about 7-8 minutes.
Okay, thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to thank members for their contribution to this afternoon's very productive and I think many people in the gallery will take the view quite historic debate. As I said in my opening remarks, the bill has enjoyed strong cross-party support from the start, and it's clear that there is a great deal of interest in British Sign Language and in the experience of deaf BSL users in our communities from right across the chamber. I'd like to add my own congratulations and thanks indeed to the committee convener Stuart Maxwell, Deputy Convener Siobhan McMahon and all the members of the Education and Culture Committee for their very detailed and careful consideration of the bill, which, as has been said, I think allowed the bill to be improved and strengthened. The Scottish Parliament has, Presiding Officer, been applauded for the approach it has taken to ensure that its work on the BSL bill is accessible to deaf BSL users. That's in thanks partly to the committee, to the Parliament itself, and I hope to a new understanding that we have more generally as a society in the importance of being inclusive in that way. Yes,
Dennis Robertson.
I wonder if Dr. Allen would like to also put on record the thanks to the parliamentary staff who have worked tirelessly to ensure that all our deaf and deafblind people here in the gallery in the overspill have been adequately looked after and accommodated in terms of the requirements.
Minister.
Yes, I will happily echo those remarks, and as I've indicated as well, it isn't often, other than that First Minister's questions when there is an organised fight put on every week, it isn't often that we see the gallery as full as we have today, and I think that tells its own and very important story about the subject matter at hand. I want to comment on a couple of contributions that were made, and firstly, Mr. Griffin mentioned an incident about a lack of interpretation in hospital. It's an incident I know about, and it's one that the Scottish Government is addressing with the support of the Equality and Human Rights Commissioner. I don't want to pretend, Presiding Officer, for a moment, that the existence of legislation of this kind will overnight transform all these situations, but I very much believe it does strengthen the hand of all those who campaign to put those situations right. Mary Scanlon, in her contribution, generously said she would wait till I stood up and started speaking before I needed to answer her question. I do slightly feel as if I was intervened upon while silent, but she made a very important and indeed a very pertinent point. She asked about, amongst other things, the role that schools can play in providing BSL more generally beyond the deaf community. BSL can be offered as part of 1 plus 2, and Scotland's National Centre for Languages can advise schools about how BSL can fit into their language learning plans alongside other languages. I do recognise that there is some work to be done in this area to ensure that BSL learners can progress in their language learning in the same way as spoken languages. I'm very happy to explore that and to keep in touch with the member about the issues that she rightly raises. Dennis Robertson pointed to the great willingness that there is beyond the deaf community to learn BSL, which is something which I hope we can now all work together to try to meet that demand. Liam MacArthur and others pointed to the importance of deaf people accessing services in their own language. Contact Scotland, I should say, is an organisation which enables deaf BSL users to contact public services by phone. But I absolutely recognise that this does not replace the need for face-to-face interpretation. I will do my best to ensure that the levels of participation, which many members have mentioned, which surrounded the bill's passage through the Parliament, are sustained through the bill's implementation if passed in a few minutes' time. I would also like to thank the deaf and deaf-blind community and the many organisations who work with them for their contribution to the bill. As I mentioned, many of them are here in the gallery, and I know that there are many, many more watching the debate online. By sharing their experiences and insights with us, they have helped us to gain a better understanding of the needs of BSL users and of what those users need from us. Not all people's experiences around the country, of course, are the same. I would particularly like to mention in that context the very different needs that there are of deaf people in remote and rural areas. I represent 13 islands, and I know of BSL users who find it difficult to access a conversation, never mind services, in their own language within many, many miles radius. I particularly like to put on record my thanks to the five organisations who make up the Deaf Sector Partnership, all of whom I think are here present in the gallery today. They are the British Deaf Association, Scottish Council on Deafness, Deaf Action, Deaf Connections and Deaf Blind Scotland. I'm very grateful for their work with us over the last few months, which has helped us to prepare for implementation of the bill, and I look forward to continuing to work with them over the coming months as we work to establish the BSL National Advisory Group and start to work on the BSL National Plan. And finally, I would again like to thank Mark Griffin for proposing the bill in the first place. He has made a significant contribution to improving the lives of deaf and deaf-blind BSL users in Scotland, and he should feel proud of that. Presiding Officer, we have made a good start, but it is clear that there is much more that can be done and much that we must do across Scotland to help ensure that in the future we remove the barriers which still in many cases prevent deaf and deaf-blind BSL users from maximising their potential and making their fullest contribution to daily and public life in Scotland. The BSL Scotland Bill sets us firmly on the right path to address this, and I would therefore urge my fellow members from across all political parties to vote in favour of this bill.
Thank you, Minister. I now call Mark Griffin. Mr Griffin, I would be obliged if you would continue until 5 o'clock.
Okay. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to thank the Minister and members for the valuable contribution to this debate and those organisations outside of the Chamber who have provided fantastic supportive briefings. I would also like to thank the interpreters who have been at the back of the Chamber interpreting everything that has been going on, and particularly to the hands-on tactile BSL interpreters who will be in the gallery doing one-to-one interpretation for any deafblind members in the audience. I know that they will be very tired by this point. I would just like to briefly remind members of some key facts about BSL in Scotland. According to the latest census figures, there are approximately 12,000 BSL users in Scotland. Although there's thought to be a great deal of underreporting there due to issues with BSL users being able to access a census form in written English, but nevertheless, 12,000 is the figure that we have. It's estimated that 120 children a year are born with a hearing loss, the majority of whom are born to hearing parents. And as you can imagine, a child being born with a hearing loss can have a huge impact on parents, guardians, brothers and sisters and other family members, which Mary Scanlon has pointed out, and I support our call for lessons for family members of children who are born deaf, and that being provided at a very early stage of a child's development. Scotland has a serious shortage of BSL trained teachers, which has an obvious effect on the number of deaf children able to access their education. It was raised repeatedly by Rhoda Grant, Cara Hilton and Siobhan McMahon. Siobhan McMahon quoted Scottish Government figures which showed that only 36.4% of deaf pupils attained hires or advanced hires in comparison with 60.2% of hearing pupils, and only 26% of deaf school leavers gone to higher education compared with 39% of hearing school leavers. Now that comes down to an issue of the language skills of the teachers. It's not difficult to see why there's an attainment gap when a BSL user can be taught complex subjects like maths, physics, chemistry, when the proficiency of the language skills of the teacher is lower than the learner itself. And I think that's something we'll need to look at in the future to bring that attainment gap down. Now, that skills gap can then lead to a higher rate of unemployment amongst young deaf people. Data from a Deaf Achievement Scotland project shows that the unemployment rate of young deaf people aged 16 to 24 was 49% compared to 19% of all young people. And as I stated at stage one, one of the reasons we need this legislation is to encourage education providers to think about how deaf children can be educated in the language and in the culture that they belong, rather than forcing their own methods of education on those children. I hope that my bill can go some way towards that. Dr. Allen had said in his opening speech, and I fully agree with him, we're missing out on what deaf and deaf-blind people have to offer society and the world of work, and we can no longer afford to do so. One of the reasons for my attempting to introduce a British Sign Language Bill was personal. Mary Scannon mentioned that earlier. It was two of my great-grandparents who were deaf-blind. Now, I never met them because they died before I was born, but I was brought up with stories from my mum and from her mum about how they raised their children, the difficulties they faced, how they interacted with their children and grandchildren, how they attempted to access services and carry out everyday activities with a dual sensory impairment that we just take for granted. And when I became an MSP, I joined the cross-party group on deafness, where I heard some of the experiences of the people in that group, and I was sad to learn that almost three generations later, people are still experiencing the same difficulties in accessing services, including medical and police, and in educational attainment. And it struck me that the language is still marginalised and misunderstood. Now, I'm under no illusion that this bill is anything other than a starting point. It's the starting point for a continuous cycle of improvement in access to services for BSL users. It aims to raise awareness of the language, to highlight gaps in provision, and to identify and enable the sharing of good practice. Now, the Education and Culture Committee heard evidence from witnesses who gave examples of how a lack of awareness of BSL affected their everyday lives. One witness told the committee about going into hospital, having experience of having to wait hours, days after appointments, weeks and months after appointments, without actually knowing what was going on, about able to communicate what their symptoms were, about able to get information about their medication and how to take it, because no BSL interpreter was available to help. And I hope that that video relay service is available for every member of the BSL community who accesses any medical services. Now, Mary Scanlon spoke about the number of BSL interpreters that we have and the debate and discussion around the number. Now, the number I have is that we have 80 registered BSL interpreters in Scotland, whereas in Finland, a country that has a similar population to Scotland, has 750. And I hope that if this bill is passed, the promotion of BSL in public life will lead to a resurgence of the language and an interest amongst all people in learning it, which hopefully will in turn cause an increase in the number of interpreters who come into the system. Many organisations have already made great progress. I don't think anyone would deny that when we hear examples of what the NHS have done with the video relay service in considering the needs of BSL users. And it's time that experience is shared across the public sector so that others can start to catch up with them. I recognise it's not possible to wave a magic wand and instantly enable BSL users to start using the language every time they engage with the health service, educational establishments and others. I wish I could do that, but I believe that the bill is an important first step in putting BSL on a firmer footing, and that it will make a positive difference to the lives of BSL users. Now, over the course
of taking this bill through Parliament. It's often mentioned that the Equality Act 2010 is in place and that that should be enough to cover the needs of BSL users. And I think it's important that I state, and others have stated, and that deaf BSL users do not define themselves as disabled. They are intellectually and physically as capable as any member in here, and they resent the fact that they have to define themselves as disabled to access services that we take for granted. We don't go to a foreign country and define ourselves as disabled. This is about people communicating in their own language. Now, we have to recognise that there is a minority in Scotland who use a different language, who have no opportunity to learn the Indigenous spoken language, and it's up to us to address that and adapt to our services accordingly. I hope that this bill will pass. I hope that this bill will achieve that aim, and I commend the British Sign Language Scotland Bill to Parliament today. Thank you.
That concludes the debate on the British Sign Language Scotland Bill. We now move to the next item of business, which is consideration of a Parliamentary Bureau motion. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14291 on approval of an SSI.
Moved.
The question on this motion will be put at decision time, to which we now come. Because this is a very important day, we have a very important person. We have Shauna Dixon, who is going to sign decision time for us. There are five questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is amendment number 14272.3 in the name of Sarah Boyack, which seeks to amend motion number 14272 in the name of Fergus Ewing on the future of renewables in Scotland's energy policy be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 14272.3 in the name of Sarah Boyack is as follows. Yes, 33. No, 72. There were four abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question is amendment number 14272.1 in the name of Murdo Fraser, which seeks to amend motion number 14272 in the name of Fergus Ewing, on the future of renewables in Scotland's energy policy, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 14272.1 in the name of Murdo Fraser is as follows. Yes, 13. No, 96. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14272 in the name of Fergus Ewing on the future of renewables and Scotland's energy policy be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 14272 in the name of Fergus Ewing is as follows. Yes, 63. No, 13. There were 33 abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is at motion number 14291 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on approval of an SSI be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is at motion number 14111 in the name of Mark Griffin on the British Sign Language Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to, and the British Sign Language Scotland Bill is passed. May I take this opportunity to thank Mark Griffin, the Government, the Education Committee, for all their work in bringing the bill to this stage. My thanks too to our parliamentary staff who have excelled themselves. Can I also take this opportunity to thank all of our signers today? You have done a fantastic job, and the whole of the Parliament thanks you for that. This bill... Members can see for themselves the reaction from the blind and deafblind community as to how much this bill means to them. So can I say to members, thank you. That ends decision time. I now conclude this business.